So my name's Cassidy Olson. This is my classroom. I was the coach here for like 8 years. We have a tool that will fit any, whatever level you're coaching at. And then from the start, my angle is not, we're teaching you this is the way you have to coach. It's, you guys all have jobs. You know, you scrambled to get here tonight and we appreciate it. You're gonna take off early to go get to practice. We wanna make it easy for you and give you guys drills that you can run a good efficient practice and stuff to plan. Really preaching the idea of process over results. One of the first time I saw a five-year-old game, the best kid on the field is a shortstop and he picks the ball up and he runs over and gets an out at first and everyone, that's awesome, we got an out. That's great, but in reality, you know, you don't see that very often in Wrigley Field. So, the best thing is to teach him, hey, throw that thing across and the kid who closes his eyes and throws the glove up, you know, he might catch it one time and it'll be, one, they're going to develop better, and two, you know, you'll feel better about them doing the right thing. So one of the things for you older groups, and we did this in high school, is batting average is the devil. It's the worst thing in the world because it's not a good stat. They still keep it, you know, for traditional reasons, but quality at bats is what we always talked about. So if a kid lines out to shortstop, you know, he shouldn't be feeling down about himself, and the kid who hits a little blooper that happens to find a spot in the field should be thinking about what can I do better next time, right? So we took a totally different stat. It was all quality at bats. You know, if you move runners over, again, that's older kids, but it's something you can start thinking about right away. You know, praise the kid who got out but hit the ball hard, and don't get on the kid who didn't hit it hard and got on base, but try to coach him up for the next time they're up. So with that, Dan Keller, a former teammate of mine at UCLA, he grew up in Fountain Valley. You know, he was a great pitcher down there and has coached all over. We both got a chance to coach in Cape Cod a few years back, which is a really good college summer league. He's coached at Fountain Valley High School at Cypress Junior College. Really a lot of coaching experience and a ton of camp and youth experience too, which is why I think he's so good at this. And so his newest deal here is basically a tool for you guys to go in and help you with your practice plan. So with that, I'll turn it over to Dan.
Thank you, and I'm fired up to be here at South Bay. You'll notice we threw up a beta logo on our website to build that community. One thing that Cass mentioned, process, not results. One of my favorite phrases as a pitching coach. So my specialty is pitching. My last in-uniform gig was Cypress College, 3 years, a year out in Cape Cod, coaching the best pitchers in the nation collegiately. I'm back at the high school ranks assisting. I'm not going to be in uniform this year, but pitching is my expertise, and process, not results, is everything, right? Just and really, as a parent, I think that's probably what we should all focus on, rewarding the effort, not the victory or the talent, and teaching these kids to grow as human beings. That's the purpose and the point of Dugout Captain. And here's what we believe. We believe that the game can teach athletes like nothing else. And Dugout Captain is the official practice planning and coaches tool for Pony International. So we have an international partnership with Pony because they recognize that they're losing the kids. We'd all look at the game and say, kids aren't playing baseball the way they used to play, the way that we played. And it's because the game isn't fun. More specifically, it's because their practice experience is poor. That's what the common sense answer is. That's what the research shows. MLB's throwing huge dollars, huge effort at it. It's a huge, huge problem. The average MLB fan is something like 52. And so they go, man, if we don't change this, the game's gonna pass them by. And the youth numbers have been dwindling for like years straight. And so Dugout Captain's purpose is to extend the young person's playing career. If we can take a kid, take him from 2 years to 3 years, or three seasons to five seasons, we give the game more time to teach. And you know, and truly, you know, it sounds kind of fluffy, but if we all look at why you got off work early to be here at 6 p.m., it's so you can serve these kids better, right? You got a chance for the next 3.5 months with 12 knuckleheads to make a real, real impact in their development. And that's not just baseball. I played Fountain Valley, but Fountain Valley Pony with just a great group of guys, and I think they were pretty talented. Most important thing when I look back about that success is I've yet to see the same type of success for a single team. And this is what happened. Zero guys made any money, and all of us are working stiffs, right? But I can tell you this. My left fielder married me, my pastor. My center fielder, I see every fall when my wife's business trip takes us to Hawaii. My right fielder has 5 kids. I never see him. First baseman, I went to his house for the Super Bowl party. Second baseman, I went to San Pedro on Sunday. I'm the godfather of his son. Shortstop was me. Third baseman, I see at Monday night softball, old man softball. The other pitcher, is one of my best friends, Luke Hudson. So I go around that group of kids. That's the same group of kids I played baseball at 8 years old. How many people coach an 8 year olds here? Right? Those guys are forming life partnerships, life friendships right now. And it's crazy to think about that. Oh my God, we're that age where our kids are doing that. But that's the impact that we have. The reason why I share that story is, one, we could play a little bit. Two, it's true, we're all not going to go play in the big leagues, right? But that doesn't mean we don't have to sacrifice coaching to prepare them for that. So if they get that opportunity, we're going to do everything we can on the field of play to prepare them for that. Or if the big man calls their number and they stay healthy and they get opportunity and they get developed, they will have the chance to go progress a level. But what we won't sacrifice is a smile on their face at the end of the day being exhausted with a great practice. And that's the process of stepping up that day and putting the effort. You're already going to do 20 hours a week, 20 hours a month on the field. Make it selfish, where your time is more fulfilling by running a better practice. And those kids will thrive. And that's where it's an easy connection to go, Dugout Captain, well, how are we going to help you do that? And that's where we go into now. We believe development happens in three ways: physical, mental, and in character, and probably in the opposite order. So everything we do, again, screams to those developmental philosophies. I'm gonna click to a screen right now. Welcome to Dugout Captain. I'm gonna go into our clipboard here, and I'm gonna grab a 120-minute practice. So that would be an over-the-top baseball guy, eye black, shorts tucked in, getting after it with a two-hour practice, right? The reason I put this up is I want to walk through very quickly our practice planning philosophy and just give a little bit of a background about how and why we build our practice plan. Then I'm going to come back to a macro level and show you the way we've organized the content, and we'll get back and then we'll get into kind of philosophy along the way. So practice planning 101, we have 8 absolutes that we teach. And Dugout Captain, the tool, is built on these 8 absolutes. First thing here, we have a pre-practice and a practice. So our first item of these 8, following these kind of gold colored boxes, it's an early activity. We have warm up, early base running, throwing, and it goes from there. Conceptually, early activity. I'm not gonna go through all 8, I won't take that much time, but I'll use early activity as a quick example. This is 15 minutes before your practice starts. So if you're saying my practice starts at 4 o'clock, at 4:45, myself or one of my assistant coaches is going to run a drill. It's gonna be a fun drill and typically an offensive minded swinging drill because kids like to swing. The concept of that drill is to get practice to start at 4 o'clock. So by after 2 or 3 practices, when kids start realizing they're not a part of this fun practice, they're showing up and seeing guys yelling or pegging each other or hitting water balloons or doing something fun, they go, Mom, God, I want to be a part of that. Dad, get me there on time, let's go. And pretty soon, 3 or 4 practices in, I promise you this works. You're starting your practice with 10 out of 12 guys in uniform, gear in the dugout, gloves where they need to be, lined up, ready to go. And especially if you're sharing field and I'm in Huntington Beach now, we have to pay for all our fields. I mean, there's just no field space. That's precious time. So if you can get set up 15 minutes early, you can get an assistant coach running a BP based drill, go set up your field and get the kids swinging. That's a concept of early activity. One thing I'll point out right now, these little camera icons right here launch a what is early activity. So what I just told you, if you want a really good looking guy to tell you what it is,
early activity.
Then
this is the first practice absolute in the Dugout Captain philosophy.
But the funny thing is I'm standing right here. So I'll X out of that. But each of these segments have a little bit of how-to video to remind you, well, what's this Dan Keller guy and Dugout Captain all about? Well, if you want to hear why we put it there, you can go for it. By the way, if you're like, yeah, that guy sucks, boom. You can exit out, get rid of it. So I'll reset by grabbing one of my blank plans to 120 minute practice guy, and there we go. We have 8 segments. Early activity was number 1. I keep scrolling quickly, we've got a warm up. Early base running is something we insert at the end of our warm up. Remember, this is a 2 hour practice. We've got 120 minute, 90 minute, and 60 minute. So by the time you get to a 60 minute practice, you're warming up, you're playing catch, you're running a couple drills, you're switching, you're running the bases, and you're getting out of there. Right? This is over-the-top practice guy that wants to structure something at the end of his warm-up called early base running. What that is this. When you finish your stretching, you should be doing sprint work. So any camp or practice you do, you're going to check the box to say, I've got the kids to 100% heat. They got a little sweat. We're ready to take the field. We teach during that segment. So if I've got 5 sprints or 6 sprints, I'm gonna reinforce my base running from the previous practice. So if I maybe taught tagging up, or I taught first to third, picking up a coach, you think about all these little things that we're responsible to teach. I'm going to reinforce that during the 6 sprints I do during early base running. It's going to be simple. It's going to be quick, super quick. As soon as I get done with warm-up, hey, we're doing a tagging up drill, which I could find in a category on the left-hand side called practice early activity. And I could find, I could find tagging up. There's tagging up. If I click that right now, I'll get a drill detail. I'll give you a little snippet of what Dugout Captain's all about. Early base running, we're doing tagging up. We're gonna start this drill with the first group walking out to the white cone. First guy's gotta stay a step back. We're gonna simulate a ball being hit into the outfield. That runner running back to the base, tagging up, and trying to advance. 2 steps to this drill. When I raise my hand, that means the ball is hit and our athletes are gonna go back to the red cone, getting that tag up position. When the ball hits my hand, they'll break, tagging up to try to advance to the next base. Keywords obviously are, guys, you ready? We'll go ahead and do it. Back! They get back into a tag up athletic position. They're gonna look and listen, go! And take off and advance. Next group, out to the white cone, jog please. When I raise my hand, you're gonna return, get in that tag up position. Back, tag up, look and listen. And they go, good, out to the white cone. First guy's gotta stay a step back. Keywords obviously are, back. They're gonna look and listen, they'll break when the ball hits my hand to try to advance to the next base. Here's our sprint work, right? The end of our dynamic training. We're gonna take these 4 to 6 sprints and we're gonna work on tagging up. Okay, so very quickly, I think what's more important to show is what we've built at Dugout Captain as I get into the content that's available is we've programmed and layered our instruction. So at any age, at any length of practice, we've got a series of practice plans to hold your hand and kind of guide your development. It's above and beyond where if you never took a look at it or you don't need it, it doesn't matter. It's always there for you. It's kind of like Dugout Captain has your back, whether you like it or not. But the idea of our layering is, in theory, when we finish the previous practice, maybe we involve tagging up. Or at the end of this practice, I've got a base running drill that's a multi-purpose drill, where I'm gonna run a home to first, I'm gonna run a first to third, and I'm gonna run a runner at third doing tagging up. So maybe I'll take 6 sprints and 5 minutes to teach tagging up at the end of my warm-up and then apply that later. So we've done a lot of layering, and there's another segment that I'll get into that we do here. So we got here 15 minutes early, we ran our early activity. The point of early activity is to start practice on time. If my practice is 4 o'clock, I'm blowing my whistle at 4:00, boom. And I'm setting the stage from day number one, like a classroom teacher would tell you, I'm gonna be firm, I'm gonna be loving, but let's not waste each other's time. Practice is gonna start at 4 o'clock. And when you show up late, I'm gonna let you know you're late so your parent hears. I'm gonna make sure I'm vocal and they know, hey, I'm taking off work early, I'm taking some time to prep this practice. I know life happens, but hey, it's important for you to be on time. And you gotta establish those ground rules early. It's gonna hold you accountable as a coach. If you go through and take the time to plan this practice, then when you show up the field, you're gonna take it more serious than you would if you didn't. And again, who's gonna benefit? You are selfishly, because your manager responsibilities are here. They provide you the opportunity to coach. If you don't handle the manager responsibilities, everybody's had that frustrating coach experience where you got 12 guys looking at you going, and you fall back into your comfort practice. We all have a comfort practice that we run probably 7 out of 10 times. We're trying to change that to give you something fresh, whether it's a drill, a new plan, or give you content to improve. Okay, finish with early base running. We get into our throwing. We'll leave that alone. We finish throwing, I want to highlight quick defense. Quick defense is 5 or 10 minutes, 5 or 7 minutes skill training. So let me pull up a, there it is. I'm gonna pull up this drill, baseball basics, just so I can use the, this right here as a guide. Okay, so if we're running our warm-up, we're getting down the road on practice planning, I apologize here, but if we're running our warm-up, we call it a dynamic warm-up box. So we're all American, baby. Red, white, which I'll make black right here, and then blue to make a 5-yard, 5-yard. And here are my athletes. I got 3 lines of 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. And these are my 12 soldiers ready to rock. The goal with early activity is that I've got my athletes gear in the dugout. They need everything they need for today. They take it out either along a fence line or wherever the equipment goes. They jump into a drill early activity. We blow the whistle on time. We fall back to our dynamic warm-up. We're going to do a free-flowing movement-based warm-up to get that sweat. As soon as we've got them up to 100% sweat, we're going to do an early base running. We're going to reinforce something that we taught or preview something we're about to teach. We're layering our instruction. We break into catch play. We'll leave that alone. As soon as we're done with catch play, we're going to collapse back to this box, the same format, for a little skill training. And here's the concept of what and why. Quick defense builds hands and feet. It takes away the field of play. So imagine a rundown where you're teaching pickle. You're teaching rundowns. Typically, when we teach rundowns, you've got, you know, a shortstop or a first baseman, a runner in the middle with a helmet, and you've quickly got chaos. We would teach a running dart during quick defense, which is the physical movement of running and throwing a dart. Running and throwing a dart. And all we're going to do during quick defense is have a baseball in the hand, run. When you cross the white cone, toss it to the coach. Maybe take off for a football pattern on the way back, because we're going to make smiles happen, right? Next time through, run on a verbal. Now, throw that dart. And if you've ever tried to teach a rundown, you're probably going to get 92 at the shin, right? Wah! And they're going to ball fake you to make sure you can't catch it. Running darts simply teaches the movement in 5 minutes, because we're going to do rundowns later in the practice. And we've programmed that from start to finish, soup to nuts. You don't have to know that. You don't have to follow it, but it's there for you. We have your back. Quick defense in a nutshell, right? And we've got some great drills in the category. You could search by segment quick defense to find drills that would fill that area. In our DC practice plans, we've selected those based on the development, okay? All right, we've played catch. We come back to quick defense. Now we're into your two stations, your running drills, your traditional practice, you're swapping, maybe a water break in between. Maybe you're running two sets of drills, defensive drills and offensive drills second, because kids like to hit. That's a carrot at the end of the stick. When you're done with your stations, you're moving into base running and a finish. Pretty standard, right? So here are our 8 segments real quick. We start with our early activity. We move through a warm-up, early base running if you're over the top, you're trying to get something out of the sprint work, into throwing. Quick defense is a little bit much, right? You're thinking skill training, just hands and feet. Maybe a receiving drill for the young kids. Just here, maybe a ground ball, foot here. Quick catch, right foot, left foot, boom. Ground ball 2, right foot, left foot. Quick catch, right foot, left foot, because we just worked footwork and ground ball instruction the previous practice. Get through your quick defense. You've got your traditional drills or stations, multiple stations, breaking the kids up. Finishing with our drills, base running, and a mental finish. Let's step back and realize now what this tool is that we've built. Everybody, when you get your login, or if you have logged in, this is my dugout. You'll land here at your command center, and you got 4 main action items. You can jump in and plan a practice, think team. You can train a skill or fix a problem, think more individual or homework based. Or you can jump into the library and just start looking for drills. Okay. Conceptually, the way we built this, Cass mentioned some goals. On the clipboard, the bottom left-hand side here, we've got a link for you called the Athlete Development Plan. I've opened that up in another window here. It's a full curriculum. There's actually a 75-page ebook that's there for you anytime you need it to hold your hand and guide you through, like a running narrative through your experience. So what we did was, by age, we put bullet point objectives and practice plans to achieve those objectives. So if I scroll really quickly through this, we've got big picture plan, philosophy of why we're doing what we're doing, development versus competition. Do you have a coaching philosophy written down? How are you going to handle playing time? How are you going to handle positions played? Parents are nuts. You will be challenged. Put something in writing and have your parents sign it. Get in front of it, because you're going to have to make a decision in the bottom of the 6th when you know you pitch this guy, you win, you pitch this guy, you lose, but it's the right thing to do to pitch him. If you have something in writing, it's going to hold you accountable. It's way easier to face your parents and go, I know, but the right thing to do is to pitch number B. Okay, practice planning, a little bit of overview. Here are our 8 steps. We don't need to do that because we're in person. A little bit more about the site and the tools available. I'm going quickly because I'm trying to get to a header for you. Now, here we go, start the engine. Coaching equipment, player equipment, that team meeting, some highlights about what we want to accomplish during that meeting, coaching philosophy, define, establish, communicate. Then very quickly we get into T-ball. T-ball, good luck. Bottom line is this, we've got a one-page narrative to get you warmed up. Now here are your objectives. Again, do you ever gonna check these? I don't know, if you want to, we got your back. Because here's what we believe you should be exposed to and not proficient with. We can't guarantee that all athletes will have the skill set or the makeup or they show up, but what we can guarantee is that you have checked the boxes on these objectives if you follow the DC practice plans. And I can pass my 6-year-olds to the 8-year-old level and my 8U, my Pintos to the Mustang level, the Mustang to the Bronco level. Wouldn't that be a different world if we really could follow a curriculum and pass those kids from level to level? That's the way this is going. That's the way that Pony Baseball, that's the way all organizations want to, probably should lean on education and say, that's the goal, right? So we've got that covered here. And I could continue to go through each level with bullet point objectives, which I don't expect you to memorize.
Dan, let me just say something real quick.
The comfort practice, I'm guilty of it. I'm coaching basketball right now. I don't know anything about basketball. Right, you show up, oh shoot, 3-man weave, let's go, right? Like just do something that you remember from before. But if you put in the 15 minutes before that practice and you got it on paper when you show up, you're going to feel so much better about how the practice goes.
Yeah, and this will be, hopefully, I'll tie this together so it's a lot of content. We've actually gotten that as a critique, that there's a lot of content available for you. We want to make sure we alleviate anxiety, we give you a tool to give you a chance for success. Again, if we make your experience more fulfilling, and once you really kind of get through the learning curve of realizing what's available for you at Dugout Captain, we really believe it's going to change your experience. If we change your experience, I look in the room, I see 40 individuals, I say we have 480 kids. You know, that's the way I look at it. We have a chance to impact 480 kids, and that's very, very powerful. So let me fast forward here. We've got this curriculum available for you. Bullet point objectives by age. We got a running narrative to get you in. Then how do we accomplish that? Boom. We start seeing practice plans. Now this is your print version of our T-ball number one. So this is what a free member or your parent will receive if you share a practice plan with them. So imagine that I showed up and I roll up to the yard and I let my kid run out to put his gear down if I'm an assistant coach and you've shared a practice with me. And I sit in the car for 98 seconds and I watch the drill video that you want me to help you run. And I walk out and either the drill's set up for me or you hand me a stack of cones and some wiffle balls and you say, hey, you ready to run wiffle ball BP or whatever that drill is I've shared with you? Yeah, I go out, I get to be a part of what's going on. I help you run this drill. We take a water break. I go back to the side, I scroll up to the second drill and I say, all right, now we're hitting, let's do 2-spot receiving. I click on 2-spot receiving, I get our drill detail page, I've got a drill video, content description, a diagram, execution keys, and our proprietary DC keys. These are the keys we learn coaching 3 to 5-year-olds, 50 of them every summer. Right? These are the keys that tell you, hey, we want kids to run through first base. So what do we tell them? We say, hit the bag. What foot do you hit the bag with? Home to first, what foot? Right foot, raise your hand. Left foot, raise your hand. Scared to answer, raise your hand. It's either. Hit the foot in rhythm. Trick question, right? So you got to hit the bag in rhythm, stop, break down, and look right. Why do you look right? Looking for an overthrow, right? Now you see the overthrow, you go. So we learned half the kids are going to miss the base regardless of what you do. But we put 2 field goal cones 10 feet past the bag. We say, you got to score a goal. You got to get past these cones. Then we put a coach standing right behind those 2 cones. And we say, kick dirt on coach. Uh-huh. Yeah, you get to kick dirt on coach. So now the kid probably 70% missed the bag because they're so excited to kick dirt. But they go running hard and they go, look right. Boom. Then we do one other thing. We put a line of cones along the fence. Only the first time you run the drill. I got a line of cones that are physically, I'm going to send the kids to the fence line and along the cone. Because we've had 2 kids run, one guy stop, turn around, boom, and 2 broken noses. I've had it. 2 broken noses on 1 collision because kids start going fast. They turn around, run right into each other. So if you run this drill 1 time and actually take the time to set up the cones along the fence line, you've got a fence line you can run the rest of the year. They understand what the fence line is, right? You've set the structure and the code words, the keywords for the rest of your year. This is a drill diagram that was a piece of the practice plan. Okay, let's get cracking. Here we go. T-ball number one was a part of this curriculum. Okay, we've got an overarching curriculum. How do we achieve the goals? Practice plans. I log into my clipboard. let's see here. Here I am. DC plans, left-hand side. I can search by age. T-ball to 14U. How old are your kids you're coaching?
T-ball, 4-year-old, 5-year-old.
T-ball, boom. I got 10 practice plans ready to go. Click on number one. We could start you with hula hoop throwing. And we could show a drill on using the hula hoop to teach the throwing mechanics. Built around the structure of engagement, efficiency, fun, giving you a chance to teach something to T-ball, which, again, good luck was the main theme on T-ball. All right, how old are your kids?
7 and 8.
Okay, so let's go 8U. We do have T-ball covered, smother and cover. 8U, how long your practice you want to be? 60, 90, 120 minutes?
Say 90 minutes.
90 minutes. Once I click into 8U, 90 minutes, I got a dozen practice plans ready to go, a game day routine, and an Olympic competition for when the kids get really burnt, they don't want to listen to you, you just want to do a fun day. I click in, let's say last practice I ran number 3, this practice I'm just going to run number 4. I click on number 4, it's preloaded with drills that built on the last practice that prepare you for the next practice. Again, do you need to know that? No. I can click in any of these drills and get the full drill detail page, right? I'll click out of that because I want to show real quick. This was 8U, 90 minute, number 4. When I'm ready, I click share. I'm just going to go straight to your email. What's your email?
Jeff B.
Jeff B.
At creativeheads.net.
Creativeheads.net. Check out today's practice. Okay, so as I keep talking, I'm just going to share that. My practice plan has been shared and saved. Going back to what we do, we had an athlete curriculum. Had bullet point objectives at each level. How do we achieve those? We got practice plans. We can search left-hand side, DC plans, by age, by duration, and give me a dozen practice plans professionally programmed with notes specific to that drill's use for that age at that point in the season.
I saw teams on there, so we load our team. I can send that whole thing. So we're loading our team, right?
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah, exactly right. Remind me on that. We'll get back to the share features, the most important part of what we're doing. Yes. Conceptually, I just want to share one more thing, right? These practice plans are the dugout captain's suggested plans that if you were short on time, if you wanted to follow the protocol, you could log in and always have a practice plan ready for you. 5 clicks. That's why I wanted to show that quickly was here. You log in, I grab 8U number 4, and I share. Boom, done. I could select team, I could select contacts, I can put in an email right now and it can fire something out to my free members, my teams. You guys all have. I also want to show you, we have my plans, the ones I've shared, or the ones I've saved. Shared plans, if I say, hey, will you share me that practice plan? That was awesome. Share me with me what you got going on. We want to create that community. Then I've got 2 ways to build my own. I've got blank templates. Those are the 60, 90, 120. Let's pull up a 60 here and just reset my clipboard. That's going to show your basic, your T-ball practice, right? And very quickly, I see I've got a warm-up. We play catch. We're going to run a couple drills, switch in between, and run the bases. We're going to finish. A really simple 60-minute practice. With the interactive feature here of the clipboard, I click drills. I organize either by those practice segments here, early activity, warm-up, early base running, throwing, quick defense, and I can start dragging and dropping. Hey, I want a warm-up drill. Let's use basketball lines. I drag it, I drop it, boom, basketball lines is loaded. I could add a note, hey, this was the drill where we need the hula hoops. Make sure I remind so-and-so to bring extra baseballs. I can also search by your traditional alphabetical listing of skills and get in here and just find a drill. And if I want to drag and drop and create my own practice plan, boom, I've got a drill loaded, I add it, I share it. The last way, showing the clipboard real quick in practice plans, I can customize my own. So I can click this reset button. I can move in and get a blank template, a blank slate, say this Keller guy's full of garbage. Here's what I want to do. I want to make my own. I can go to customize. I've got my pre-practice segment and my practice segment. So if I want to run a drill, I grab a drill, I drag it right there. I'm going to run a pre-practice drill, early activity drill. Then down below, I'm going to run a drill. Maybe I'll add a water break. And then I'll add some stations. You know what? I've got 3 coaches. I am over the top guy. Let's add a drill. And I can start dragging and dropping and adjusting times, and the clipboard adjusts everything for you. So as soon as you build out, let's say you take the time to build out your, what do we call it, your comfort practice. You could build your comfort practice the way you like it. And even if you just want to put in your own names, you can put in your own names, you know, for awesome drill one, because you are awesome. And then down below would be awesome drill two. And then down the road, if you want to find some fresh information or you want to check out the drill library, you find some drills, you drag and drop. Hey, that drill didn't work. Let me try something else. You can search by skill, by age. So what fills those practice plans? I click library at the top. I can always go look in the drill library. Over 200 youth-specific, pony-friendly, unique drills. Built on the premise of keeping kids engaged, making sure they're efficient. I'm using winning and losing in competition to teach skills, but I'm developing champions in case their name gets called to be big leaguers. We're gonna make sure we prepare every kid to be in the big leagues, but we're not gonna sacrifice anything developmental based. These drills organized, practice segments, skills. Either way you wanna go. You can log in and find what you need to find. And there is a lot of content in there, so jump in there, have some fun. Let's dive real quick into the question, and I'll go one more kind of technical, and then we'll get back to kind of the reason why we're in the room. I'm gonna go back to my dugout. Everybody make sure when they leave here tonight, they go, okay, all right, give me 30 minutes on the site, see if I can change your coaching experience. Here's what we wanna see. We wanna see what happens if you actually empower your assistant coaches, invite your team parents, and you share a practice with them the night before. You know, can you imagine if Cass was teaching here in the classroom and half the kids had actually read the assignment or had read the chapter before, how different the teaching experience is. Can you imagine if as you showed up to a drill, half the athletes had actually watched a video. You didn't have to spend half your station trying to explain what's going on and get them in the lines and explain the structure. Part of that's focus built on your structure. The other part of that is, hey, let's share. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to go to teams and contacts. This is the three steps I want you to remember. Teams and contacts, you're going to build a team. So I click teams and contacts. I land in coach's corner, my teams. Big blue button, build a team. Once I build a team, put in a name. Hey, let's put in South Bay Angels. Down below, I click save. As soon as I've got my team saved, I click this button on the left, says invite team member. I click invite team member. Here's my pop-up box. It says separate multiple emails by a comma. So I'm gonna put my 12 emails, my 18 emails, whatever I got, whoever's on my team, and I'm gonna send that invite out. If I do that from this team page and they register, they will be connected to your team. So when you share a practice plan or you share a drill, you get done with practice, you go, man, that drill was really tough. My guys really struggled with it. I'd love if my parents could work on that. Whether it's team-based or individual-based, you know you have those times you come home, God, I just can't get this kid enough time. He needs help with catching. He needs help with receiving. He can't turn the glove over, or he won't stay down on the ground ball, or he's scared of getting hit as we get older and we start seeing kid pitching. I can go into this tool we'll show next. I can send a drill home as homework and share it to an individual family. It really changes what you can do in impacting these kids. So we went teams and contacts, build a team, invite team member. Once I load the email addresses, it's on your parents to follow through and register. And throughout the entire season, anything you share with them, they can click in, they can see the drill videos, they can see the diagrams, they can read the what and the why. Really gives you a chance as a coach to hold the parents accountable to be a part of this. And it's transparency. So from a league perspective, the complaints they get are the practices aren't fun. You know, your seven-year-old comes home and says, my coach didn't teach me anything. Or what do your kids tell you in class? I didn't learn anything. Well, you can actually go, well, you know what? Actually, here's the practice plan we did. Let me send it to you. You got it. That's what we covered. And we'd love it if you would come show up and help us run a drill. That'd be great. Okay. Let me pull up the field on the baseball basics. These eight segments that we talked about, and we had our cones over here. We did our early activity, we fell back to a warm-up. We did our warm-up, we finished with some base running instruction very, very quickly, broke in a catch play, collapsed back to quick defense, and then went into drills. Those first five segments ending with quick defense, nowhere near need a field. outside of making sure you have space to play catch, which is very widely varying for the different kids. It's something to think about in structuring your practice plan, even your timing. If you're sharing a field or if you're cramped on space, you can really handle a lot of that off the field. A lot of the philosophy in the drills is making sure that we get that player ratio really, really low. So 3x4 is the goal. 3 coaches, 4 kids. We have a great drill in here called structured catch play. Maybe I'll even pull it up because get a lot of questions in clinic about focus. How do you make your 8-year-olds focus? Well, my kids don't pay attention. And we always put that right back on you and say, focus is created. There's no 8-year-old that pays attention. They pay attention because the ball's gonna hit them in the face if they're not paying attention, right? And the way that you structure your catch play, if you break up 6 and 6 to make 12, that means I've got 4, you've got 4, and our third assistant got 4. And if we throw on my verbal, which means the ball's on the foul line until I say throw, that means I can turn around and I've got 2 athletes I'm responsible for. And as soon as we throw, I've got 2 athletes I'm responsible for. Can I get something done if I'm coaching 2 kids? Absolutely. And they have to focus because they're going to throw. Now, throwing is unique. But that's what we believe. And to look at that practice structure, you can handle 5 of the 8 off the field, then you're getting into station work. And once you're running stations, now you're making sure I've got someone live, someone on deck, someone playing defense, and someone, you know, doing a penalty push-up, meaning I've got multiple people involved. I want to fly back to the My Dugout one last time. 2 middle buttons. Train a skill, fix a problem. Let's think more individually. Let's think, I just got done with practice and I've got a kid who really needs help with receiving. He's a safety issue. Or he wants to play catcher, but he can't catch. Or he probably wants to play shortstop and catcher at the same time, or bat leadoff and bat fourth. You're gonna get these problems. These 2 buttons take you to our homework clipboard. Or once we're in the homework clipboard, I'm gonna click DC homework. And we're essentially training skills or fixing problems. And the way that we've organized this is I can click in a train a skill. I've got the mental game, catching, pitching, hitting, and infield, where I can click into these and I've got lessons for all these skill training. These are coaching the coach trainings. In my previous life, I ran an indoor place called Lifeletics in Huntington Beach, 15 years. This is what we did. We did private instruction. So we've got your first 2 to 3, 2 to 4 lessons for these skills covered. And if I click into these lessons, that drill detail video with the description and everything is preloaded here. So if I click detail, I'm gonna get, there's my drill detail. This is how to coach pitching number 2. But in essence, we've give you the first 4 lessons that you would go down and pay $50 a pop at the local place to teach your kid how to pitch. We're gonna try and arm you with a little bit of a plan. So if I click in and I watch this video, this is our series on coaching the coach. Let's take a couple minutes.
Pitching, part number 2.
So part number 1, we established a balance point, the stance and the balance point. This second segment, we're going to establish the finish with the idea that if we can have strength and balance early and late, then we can work in between. That's power. That'll be part number 3. Always encouraging our athletes to be aggressive, throw without fear, let it rip. We're gonna establish the finish position. First things first, let's meet at the mound and let's discuss. Let's review the stance and the leg lift. Feet, hands, eyes on the stance, leg lift, knee up, foot out, toe down. Let's talk through and establish those key points and go into live pitches. Making sure the athlete is hot, let's review position number 1. We've gotta do a freeze at 1. Remember, glove is down, I'm saying up to balance point, looking for the knee up, the foot out, the toe down, stand tall, flashing the glove and getting fastballs. 3, 4, 5 reps, and it's time to teach new. We've got to add the rules to the finish. First, let's teach the finish, then let's walk through how we would do that live during repetitions. So there's 4 coaching keywords, point, click, shield, sword. Point. For the right-handed pitcher, that's our left foot. The left foot points directly towards target and bears the body weight. Click, point and click. This is a technology generation. They know point and click. Left foot points, right foot clicks. The knee is turned in, that right foot is up on the toe to shift the weight over to that left leg. Point, click. Shield, that's the glove. The glove acts like a shield in front of the body, and the sword, into the ground, flat back finish. So to understand that point, click, shield, sword. Those are easy to remember coaching keywords. And as we move into repetitions, we're going to have to hold the finish and then adjust piece by piece in that order so the athlete understands and feels what the finish position is supposed to feel like. Okay. So just to show you, we've got a series of four kind of how to coach pitching videos tied into our homework clipboard. So I can send this drill home with some specific notes. And in this case, for how to coach pitching number two, we've preloaded a lesson plan for you, the coach. So you could send this home to a parent. You could work on this with your own kid. We actually have a learn member, we call it, Dugout Captain. It's kind of a mid-tier member that doesn't get the practice planning clipboard or that content or the athlete development plan. But they get the drill library and the ability to work with their athlete. So in this skill training area, if here I have content kind of overviewing the lesson, I can now change this to every other day, change it to weekly, and pick my day, click on, click off, change it from 25 reps, say, no, this guy really needs some work, let's make it 50 minutes. And I can share this with one of my contacts. I could share with my entire team. I could pick a drill that we really struggled with when I got done and send it home. Say, parents, I need your help. We are really struggling to play catch. If you find 5 or 10 minutes an afternoon, work on receiving, you know, little guys. Maybe it's a cut and relay or running darts. Maybe we did rundowns and my shins have bruises up and down. Hey, here's a fun drill to do in the backyard as you're doing your swings or before you do your, you know, daddy me time or mommy me time. Okay. So hitting, pitching, training a skill. We jump in to fix a problem. We got the same thing going. This is where we're growing our content the most right now. I've got hitting problems. So I've got a long swing, a barrel drop, hitter throwing the bat. We've even got segments on coaching the mental game, throwing helmets, distractions. Here we go, throwing a helmet. We'll click into that and see what I had to say. Throwing a helmet. Is this a bad thing? First things first, you must discipline. And I recommend a clearly communicated rule for those type of behaviors. You're gonna sit out the next inning, you're gonna skip an at bat, whatever it is, be fair, be consistent, discipline the athlete. Secondly, let's celebrate the fact that this athlete has some fire. Let's recognize this as a positive thing, and later on you're going to be screaming to the heavens, thank you that I have a kid who cares and who wants to be good, and getting out bothers him. This is a good thing, and your challenge is to teach him to harness that energy, that intensity for good, channeling into a competitive drive and desire that will keep him working hard and desiring to be better. Throwing a helmet, maybe it's not so bad. So this is where we're going. We call them these kind of digital shorts. We started making these quick videos to address common coaching challenges, what you're gonna hit. That's essentially what we're dealing with, right, guys? The coaching the baseball is the fun part. The dealing with life, the handling distractions and disciplines. We try to provide a specific answer and kind of stay with me. We're doing this for the right reasons. So we've got one in here for throwing a bat. We've got a specific answer where it's called a trash can toss, where you take a trash can 25 feet up the line, and that athlete that's throwing a bat on his sixth swing and he's coming out and he's gonna run the bases, his job is to take that bat and jam it in the trash can. So we, for six swings, are making sure he holds on. And on that last one that's most game-like, he's taking an aggressive swing and he gets to run, yeah, whack, and drill it into the trash can. We're over time training and tricking that kid to hold onto the bat while he swings by jamming it into a trash can. We want to provide value and specifics, but we also want to speak to the philosophy of why we're doing what we're doing. My personal story, when I was injured, I was a junior at UCLA. I'd had a pretty challenging year, my sophomore year, where I wasn't as good as I had liked to be, and I didn't have anybody to help me out of it. So it was really kind of a mental struggle. And we had a lot of success that year. We went to the College World Series first time in like 30 years, and UCLA has since won a World Series, which means we're way better than we ever were. But when the game was taken from me, I found myself in the stands. So now here I was with my, you know, my arm in a sling because I just had surgery. I literally ripped my arm out of the socket enough to have a surgery to try and cinch that bad boy up, which didn't work. But it was the first time I found myself on the other side. I will never forget 3:30 taking a nap. That was the most foreign thing I've ever heard. I was like, this is what college is about? 3:30, I fell asleep on a recliner? This is awesome. But I sat in the stands and I watched a guy who got $1 million pitch against Stanford completely implode. Just couldn't handle the pressure. And this is back in the day when you could say anything you wanted to. So this guy just implodes. And I'm standing in the stands now, or sitting in the stands, and I'm one of the 94 people that are watching. And I'm looking around going, there's, you know, 92 girlfriends and parents and two people that matter. I'm just going, this is what I was so worked up about? This is it? Oh my God. And just that perspective shift to be on the other side of the diamond. Now I was probably 19, 20 years old, a little bit older. But that's what started forming Lifeletics for me. It's like, look at the powerful situation. This guy just imploded from the pressure of performing. And it changed everything. I came back from surgery the next year. I left, maybe I threw high 80s into 90. I came back throwing 80 miles an hour, but I was the best I'd ever been. Because all of a sudden, I didn't have the same fear of failure. I realized kind of perspective, like, oh, okay, I can still go to dinner with mom and dad at BJ's afterwards, and they're still gonna like me. It doesn't matter what I do. That's the concept of what we're trying to teach. We're trying to teach little buggers to care and to compete like mad, but follow that process, not results. To realize that the fear of failure is nothing. When we teach pitching, we say this: we're gonna teach the balance point in that lesson number one. We're gonna make sure knee is up, foot is out, toe is down. But what's the most important rule? Throw hard. Let it rip. No fear. Get after it. Because if I ever hamstring your ability to go hard, I'm backing off. You don't get more. That's why I always taught my guys this. You don't get more instruction if you hesitate. When we swing, we're gonna follow whatever that we're trying to follow, but if I lose the ability to let it rip, I'm backing off. I'm gonna make sure that there's no fear of failure. There are three things that I finish with. I rewrote a book on coaching pitchers. I've given over 17,000 half-hour pitching lessons. Again, 3 to 5-year-olds, and 17,000 half-hour pitching lessons. So my butt is shaped like a bucket top. My wife loves it. But I went back and I said, what are the three things that I've seen from the kids that have continued to play? Those kids that make the high school team, those kids that continue to play in college, and now I've got 7 guys that have pitched in the big leagues. I've got like 35 scholarships, and that's not me, my kids have. Not saying I'm a good coach, just saying I've seen what the kids have done, right? And I tried to come up with the big three. One was they have to love the game. They have to love the game. Those kids that keep going, they gotta have something that gets them out of bed or they wanna go down to the yard. So if your kid doesn't love the game, don't force it, create it, nurture it, right? Take them to a ball game. You know, try and sit down and watch something on TV, but you can't force it. That car ride home, we have one on here called I Love Watching You Play. If you've heard that big movement, there's a guy who's John Sullivan, who's running Changing the Game Project, who gave us those 5 words, and we scream it and preach it like no other. Like I wrote it, but I didn't. I love watching you play. That's how you drive home with your kid, right? I heard another guy at a clinic say, as soon as I shut the trunk, coach goes away and dad shows up. I thought that was beautiful. I shut the trunk, no matter how much I want to talk about how his back elbow's dropping and he should have caught that ball, that umpire made a bad call, boom, it's done. So I go, how many times you drove home with that trunk up in the air? But one, I think they have to love the game. I can think back to my college roommates. I had 5 college roommates playing the big leagues. That's ridiculous. One of the guys, you can guess who it is, I woke up to taking naked dry hacks, meaning he's swinging his bat naked. I would come home all the time. He's in the living room taking swings. Whack. Not always naked, just once. Whack, taking swings. Another guy at 8 a.m., rain or shine, would roll out of bed and run his 3 miles. Left-handed pitcher, pitch with the Phillies, Jaquez. Pitch with the Phillies and the White Sox and the big leagues. And what would I do at 8 a.m.? I'd go from left cheek to right cheek. They got to love the game. The second thing I had was drive. And this is the one, I don't know how we teach drive. But I can tell you this much. The willingness to get up on that 8th time after you've been knocked down 7 times, that's it. And that's what we're trying to teach. We're trying to teach, if we're doing a side-to-side drill where you've got to move for me and I'm trying to get footwork firing, right? We call this pop footwork, a real athletic movement. So in our How to Coach Infield series, we go 1, we're going to teach fielding triangle and exit footwork. And we break down, we try and give you a plan. Ball's in the glove. I'm not going to teach ground balls with the ground ball. I'm going to teach ground balls with the ball in the glove and provide success so he can feel feet, go. It kind of screams to trying to teach rundowns and they've never done a running dart. I'm going to teach ground balls, ball and glove. Two, I'm going to add an athletic movement. We call it a pop. Three, we're going to add lateral movement. So we're going to layer that instruction drill by drill. And each of those drills is going to follow the structure to give you success. We're going to verbally say and show. We're going to give slow repetitions. We're going to go fast repetitions. We're going to finish with competition and fun. Do you need to know any of that? No, just follow the drills, right? We always follow that structure. Once I've taught the fundamentals, maybe I've walked through this how to coach infield series with my kids. Now it's a bunch of drills. Here's a drill. What are you coaching? You got T-ball kids? Well, run the drill, dumb it down, maybe a couple feeds. You got 12-year-olds? Here's the drill. Use all 5 infield feeds. But the drill becomes something that you're reinforcing what you teach to your kids at this point in the season. The structure's set up for you to provide multiple kids involved. Penalties maybe. But if I'm doing a side-to-side lateral movement drill and I score a goal on you, meaning here's our fun competition, don't let me score because I'm trying to teach side-to-side movement. When I score a goal on you, you owe me 5 push-ups. We're playing a game. I scored on you. Now here's what's going to happen. If I'm moving side to side, I've got a ball pile, which is an athlete at a cone. I'm moving here, I've got a ball pile, an athlete at a cone, and I've got someone on deck. So I'm the live athlete, and we're moving from live to ball pile to the back of the line to the ball pile and back to live, right? Well, by the time I get back in the line, that's when I'm doing my 5 push-ups. There's nobody watching me back there anyway, right? I might hold him accountable to make sure he does them, but I'm not critiquing how low he's getting, making sure his chin's touching the grass. We're not berating that push-up. But that's the carrot at the end of the stick, going to keep him working because he doesn't want to listen to you. And he doesn't want to focus because he's 8. And that's not a bad thing, right? Let's teach competition. That's my third word, compete. That's my number one. Teach the kids to compete. Right? The philosophy of South Bay Pony should be developmental based, winning second. Like John Wooden says, we practice perfect, get out of the way of games. Let the games play. Let the kids play in the games. And teach competition. Teach competition. Teach kids how to compete. I'm going to go back to my dugout. We'll talk real quick about the share feature. The real power of this and the concept behind it is you could actually, when I started doing coaching clinics, the internet didn't exist. So think about how different a coaching clinic was when there was no content available, right? It was all, now we were trying to give skills. We were trying to teach you how to pitch, teach you how to hit, teach you how to field. Now we go, dude, it's all right there. Let's figure out how to run a practice and use this stuff. And so now you can find content anywhere. Uncle YouTube has a lot of great stuff. We're trying to provide a tool that allows you to use it and allows others to be a part of it. So if I go in here and I go teams and contacts, I click build a team, it takes me to my team area. I'm going to click into one of these as a test. Here you go. This is Teams test. I've built this team. I've sent my invites to my 12 families. This is where we need to improve the most, and we're working from a user experience standpoint. If I scroll to the bottom here, these are the members who have accepted my request, right? So I've got some contacts in here who have accepted. They've come back. This may change actually in the next like 7 or 8 days, but only will improve. I've got a contact name, a role. So I can actually assign a role of player, coach, or assistant coach. If I put assistant coach here, when I'm back at the clipboard, let me go back to the clip. When I'm back at the clipboard, when I, we had mentioned, if I select a team, when I'm in that clipboard up here, let's see, I want to go, I've got 8-year-olds, I want a 60-minute, where's number one? Okay, once I'm there, I can select the team. Let's pick that team's test. And when I scroll down here, right side, I can pick the coach. If, right now, only if he's been labeled as assistant coach. So once I pick a coach, I can say, Gordon Gates, I want you to do early activity and warm up. Javier Scalina, I want you to run the warm up.
Send that to the whole team and the dads know.
They know.
What drills we got you on.
Hey, I've only assigned you one drill. When you show up, let your kid run out to practice, watch this drill video, I need your help. I mean, and once you get to a water break, you flip the field and you say, hey, watch the second drill. But you could, from this share feature, if you've built your team out, those are individual contacts you're connected with, and your team is also built. So when I click share up here, I got 3 options, team, contacts, or email. So if you wanted to just share with a couple contacts, and I'd click in here, grab a couple of contacts. And right now, you could put any email in here and it sends them an interactive practice plan. And if you get to the point where you're running a great practice, this is the goal. You get to the point where you're running a great practice where you run out of info. and you need more content, and then we got your back. Right? That means you're running a great practice. Those guys need more. Your structure is set up where kids are growing, and you've got a resource to go find that content. The question was, can I have multiple teams, multiple contacts? Absolutely. If I go into teams and contacts, I'll click up here. At my teams, you've actually got contacts. You've got requests that you've sent. I'm a league admin. This is one of the things we're going to work with the league to find out what's league metrics so we could see how many plans you've created. Have you loaded your contacts? So when we get that complaint telling me you're running a garbage practice, we got some metrics to go look at. But yeah, you can create multiple teams here, and then on the clipboard, just select the team you want to share to or individually. So I pulled this up. This is one of our contact buttons, one of our individual contacts. And you could essentially take one of your contacts, add them to one of your teams if you didn't invite from the team, or you can assign them homework. What we want to do is stay away from, like, well, who's the best and who has the most skill? It's effort-based. Are you giving me good effort and trying to improve and learning to, you know, to be, hold yourself accountable? The mobile version is sharp to view. I would not try and plan practices on it. The drag and drop feature doesn't translate well to a mobile. If you're in a bind, you could grab a practice plan and share it. But basically, we say plan on a desktop, view on a mobile. And you, once you click into it, you can get all the drills, and there it is.
And yep. Do you have a good how to do batting practice in there?
Yeah, we have a what is, like, batting practice structure, the multiple stations and areas.
Okay, watch that one. One of my biggest pet peeves about watching younger level, and it's just because I think people don't know, the typical youth batting practice, Johnny stand up there and swing 17 times until he's about to fall over. Like, you know, you should never have a kid swing more than like 5 swings at a time. They're never going to do it in a game, right? An at bat is 4 to 5 pitches. So all you're doing is just teaching him bad, I'm tired hacks at the end. So, you know, what you do at any higher level is rounds. Even if you only have time for 1 round of 5, keep it at 5. If you can get 2 rounds and 10 swings, less swings but better swings, in my opinion, is way better. And like he said, you should always have groups doing different things. You know, one group might not have a cage, but maybe a wiffle ball station or something like that, a defense station, base running, a lot of different options. And then on the idea of competing, I mean, that a lot of his stuff is based around, but it is so important. Honestly, teach him to compete now. Grab a handful, if you happen to have your old box of baseball cards, grab a stack of those old commons that are literally not even worth the paper. They go crazy for them. Like, we're going to have a competition. If you throw it through this hoop, you get a baseball card, and then they get an old, you know, Burt by Levin card, and they're all fired up. And, you know, just, it's
that's 4 cents.
It's teaching them right now that, you know, there's winners and losers in life. That's just a fact. And then the last thing, just quick little tricks on the catching their attention. This is the last thing I'm going to leave you guys with, because again, us doing camps all the time and learning how to corral these little guys and get their attention. I want everyone to clap when I catch the ball, okay? Well, I had a little trick there, huh? You got kids going haywire doing everything else, do that. Drop your gloves, clap when I catch the ball. Boom, all of a sudden they're all back with you. Or when I say team first, you guys say team last. Team first.
Team last.
Team first.
Team last.
Team first.
Team last.
They start getting a little crazy, right? They're going around. And whatever I stole those from other coaches. That's what all good coaches do, right? Find something that is your deal with your team where you can always bring them back. You just instantaneously get them back to focus, because that's all they want to do is, you know, take that glove and throw it at the partner's head or something like that. You know, the tool is incredible. It's a lot, but we'd rather give you more than too little. And this is way better and more informative than any, you know, coaching deal that I've ever done, because this isn't, you know, some of you guys are literally going to be teaching the kid not to stand on home plate this year when he bats. And others of you are going to teach the kid how to throw a changeup for the first time. And you're going to get it all on here. So
thank you for your time.
Yeah.